This is Solace Rex by Rushing. And I am five, a 5 year old.
Hi, hello, hey, everyone. And as you heard, this is a very special episode because we have one of our offspring vibes.
Solace!
Stemmy, one of the entities we have to thank for our beautiful Stemmy that we just got. So, one of our tax write-offs.
As you heard, Little Miss Solace Rush Vibes Rushing is in the building. She's always in the building, but she's on the mic. How are you doing, Little Solace?
Good.
Are you excited to be on the podcast today?
Yeah. I'm betting everyone that watches your podcast is missing me.
Is missing you.
Missing you?
Yeah.
Well, how can they miss you if this is your first time on the podcast?
No, I meant before I came on the podcast.
Oh, they were missing you before that, and that's why you're on now, so they don't have to miss you anymore.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. I don't know why I didn't put that together.
That makes sense. That makes perfect sense. Are you excited to be here?
Yeah.
Why are you so excited to be on the podcast?
Because I've never been on a podcast. I've never seen a five-year-old on a podcast before.
You could be making history. You could be one of the first five-year-olds on a podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah. Probably. So how about you tell everybody a little bit about yourself?
Okay, so I love playing with my little sister, Savvy. I love playing on my tablet. And I love going to school.
I just want to let America know that, yes, our five-year-old said she loves going to school. She did say it last in her list, but
it's on the
list.
In
no particular order. It's not in order of importance. So school matters. Raise your children the way that they should go. And pat ourselves on the back. Okay. What else about you should people know? What's your favorite color?
Pink.
What's your favorite food?
Oh, pizza, chicken nuggets.
Speaking to the mic.
Pizza, chicken nuggets.
Vegetables.
Spaghetti, broccoli.
Why are you whispering?
Broccoli and carrots.
Why are you hitting the table?
Because I'm laughing.
Solace, what's your favorite toy?
Oh, that is a hard question.
Yeah, I know you have so many.
We've
tried to throw away.
But I'm throwing away some of my toys.
Why?
Everyone should be a little surprised. I'm talking about throwing away toys, but I'm not throwing away. I'm not literally putting them in a garbage can. I'm putting them somewhere else.
You're donating them, right? So that they can go to somebody else who could play with them?
Yeah, and then it goes to somebody else, and then over and over again.
Yeah, it's cyclical, right?
Yeah.
It's just one big circle.
Yeah.
So why are we choosing to donate some of your toys?
Because I have a whole lot.
And since you have a whole lot, what don't you do?
Make a mess.
No, you do make a mess.
You don't.
Clean up your mess.
Clean up your mess.
I almost forgot that since I never clean up.
Yeah, that's probably why you forgot, because you don't ever clean up.
And Mommy gets very frustrated, so we decided
that... But I just cleaned up my Legos before I came on.
You did just clean up your Legos before
all
you came
of
on.
Them.
I appreciate that. Now we don't have to risk stepping on them. So.
Because I stepped on a Lego before.
So what have you been up to lately? Let the people know about you.
Well, I have been on the weekends. I have been staying at home. Mm-hmm. I have been having sleepovers.
Okay.
Socially distant
sleepovers, mind you.
That's not a thing. What did we just finish? Today was your first day back to school after what?
Spring break.
And what did you do? Did you do anything fun for spring break?
I did stay home a lot, but I had a lot of fun.
What did you do?
I went to my mama's house for a sleepover. Oh. I went to my mama's house for a visit. My grandma came.
Didn't we go somewhere? Didn't we go to two places?
We went to, I'm not remembering where we went.
Didn't we go and see some animals?
We went to an animal house where they not selling animals. It's kind of like a farm, but not with too many animals.
What kind of animals did we see?
We saw dogs, and I only saw dogs.
Did we see any lions?
No.
We did see lions.
No, never.
And tigers. We went to Tiger World, and we got to see some peacocks, and we saw a black snake, and a jaguar, I think it was, and a panther, and some lions and tigers. And then where else did we go with the cars?
We went to Carland.
We went to the NASCAR Hall of Fame.
It's Carland. It's literally Carland.
So, Solace, for the past year, what has been going on that has kept us at home?
Spring break.
No. A whole year.
A whole year.
Why have we had to stay home and social distance and wear masks?
Coronavirus.
Why do you sound like Cardi? Did you teach her how to say it like Cardi B?
No, you did.
No, I didn't
you
do it.
You literally did.
Was it me?
Yeah.
From a 5-year-old's perspective, what is coronavirus?
It's when you have to do only three things.
Three things? What
three things?
What three things?
Wash your hands.
Uh-huh.
6 feet apart.
Uh-huh.
Mask. That's it.
And what do those things do? They keep you from getting it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Do you wash your hands a lot?
Kind of. Kind of, sort of.
Kind of. What does that mean?
That means that I am not really making a mess on my hands a lot.
Did you make a video about washing your hands?
Yes.
You did. And what did you tell people in your video?
I told them how to wash their hands.
You did. And why is washing your hands important?
Because then you can get germs out of your bodies, out of your mouth, out of anywhere.
All from washing your hands?
If you eat food.
What are you looking at me for? I don't know.
You eat food like pizza and you have dirty hands before you ate.
Then you eat those germs, don't you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That does not have a happy ending of days.
Very true.
Happy evening
Solace.
Days.
What is your favorite song to listen to?
Huh?
What's your favorite song?
Hamilton. Frozen.
Which Hamilton song is your favorite?
All of them. All of them are my favorite because they have lots of singing. And
all right, which one, if you had to pick one
to
sing, which one would you pick?
If you had to pick one song, if someone says, Solace, sing a Hamilton song, what song are you going to sing?
I was going to sing Helpless.
Let's hear it.
Okay.
Yeah. What? Are you nervous?
I've never seen the other people.
You can do it.
Okay, here I go. Ooh. I do. Boy, I'm helpless. In the sky, I'm helpless.
That's right. Just moving your way through it.
Boom. I'm excited, high on the spotlight. I'm ready for a hot night. I'm such a transport now. I say if you really love me, you would share. I'm hot, 2 weeks left, and then I'm dressing. I found some faith, so I'm half for a lesson. I'm dying inside of my mind. I'm crying.
All right, I think that's good enough.
You did beautiful.
Amazing, sweetheart.
Beautiful. Let's see. Let's see what knowledge you have retained. Who was the 44th president of the United States?
Don't touch them.
Who's the 44th president of the United States? You love his wife. Who is the wife of the 44th president of the United States?
Mommy's been reading her book.
What's her name?
Michelle Obama.
And what's her husband's name?
Barack
Obama. Barack Obama.
You guys know
Barack Obama. Barack Obama.
So, what makes you so amazing?
Because I have lots of good jokes, and I also do ballet.
Oh, okay.
Pretty ballet.
Pretty ballet.
Yes.
Okay. What else? Tell us a joke.
Why did the cow cut the road?
Why?
Because he wanted to go to the movies.
Oh, you're so silly. I love it. What else makes you special and you?
Because I have a tablet.
You have a tablet that makes
that
you
has
special?
A unicorn case.
Okay.
Shout out to Beth, unicorn. Inside joke.
Okay. I can't believe I'm on the podcast.
So you recently became a big sister, right?
Yeah.
And how
we have a Sabi.
You have a Sabi.
Sabi in the house. Sabi in the house.
How old is Sabi?
How old?
How old is she, yeah?
One?
Yes. And what do you like about being a big sister?
Because you get to take care of other people.
You like taking care of other people?
And I like taking care of you guys.
Aw, you're so sweet.
Thank you, sweetheart.
So what do you think, if you had to give some advice, do you know what advice is?
I do not.
You do not. So advice is when you're letting someone know how to do something. So if you're giving someone advice on how to be a good big brother or big sister, what would your advice
be? Like Aiden.
Sure. What would your advice be?
It would be,
if someone says, Solace, how can I be a good big sister or good big brother?
Well, you would have to not do anything not safe or else your little sister or your little brother would copy you.
Ah, that's very true.
Do
I have another question for you. Tell me a special place you want to go.
Don't do this.
To a hotel.
You've already been to a hotel. There's anywhere you can go, anywhere in the world. Where's a special place you want to go?
The North Pole.
The North Pole?
Yeah.
I can tell you right now, Daddy will not be accompanying you.
Why
to the
North
Pole?
It's so cold.
Because then I get to play with snow.
I mean, we get snow closer to us than the North
Pole. But not a lot of snow.
So there's nowhere special in the world that you have always
wanted to force this.
Last winter, snow. No. Literally snow.
We didn't have snow last winter.
I thought you were going to say Disney World.
The one where I was eating the snow.
Oh, when you and I went out back and we built the snowman.
Yeah, we made a snowman.
That was a few years ago.
Yeah, in the backyard.
Daddy had his drone flying. Remember that? It was making...
Mm-hmm.
No, you don't remember it. I appreciate you saying yes, though. Thank you.
Like I said, I thought you were going to say Disney World.
I heard that.
Do you want to go to Disney World?
But you'd rather go to the North Pole.
Or do you
I want to go everywhere. That's the reason I want to go to the North Pole.
Travel goals.
Yes.
Travel mood.
I'm going all around the world. You should definitely.
You know mommy's going to encourage you to go all the way around the world. Do you know what countries you have been to?
That is a fun but tough question.
Is it? Okay. Let's see. You've been, there's one country that you've been to twice.
I'm thinking Canada.
Huh?
I'm thinking,
my God. Just say it loud.
Ghana.
Yes, you have been to Ghana twice. And there's another country you've been to. We went to a hotel. We were at a resort. There was a beach and a wedding and a swim-up bar.
That's that swim-up bar.
I do too. We didn't get to enjoy it as much as we should have. Mexico.
Mexico.
Mexico. We went to Cancun. So you've been to two countries.
Two countries.
Unless we count transit countries.
And Daddy almost tossed you into the ocean because you were tripping. Mm-hmm.
But that's for another.
Almost
another
taught you, day. Almost made you learn how to swim.
So, you know you're an amazing kid, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
When I do DJ Catlip, that means yes.
Okay.
DJ who?
DJ Catlip.
From that's Gabby's Dollhouse.
DJ Catlip.
That's the guy. That's the octopus.
Okay, Saul. Okay. So, that. Is there anything that you want the people listening to Rushed Vibes to know about you before you have to get on into bed and get ready for school tomorrow?
Well, I do want everyone to know. Well, you already knew that, but okay. So, what do you want to know? What you would like to know? Something really, really cool is that I have a standing tray right now that is decorated.
This is your declaration, so you can
Easter.
Tell. It's Easter. Easter. So we need Easter's
Easter
pass.
Easter bunny.
So
Easter everything.
So Easter's pass, so mommy's got to get some new Easter decorations, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we'll do Memorial Day.
Oh, yeah. All right, kiddo. Did you enjoy being on the podcast?
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that is a wrap for Solace rushing on Rush Vibe. I'm just going to mute her mic right quick because she's getting lit over here to DJ Catlip. Catnip?
Catlip.
Catlip. Yeah, so we said last week we were going to have a special guest, and our special guest was Every bit of special in more ways than one. So, Solace, mommy and daddy enjoyed having you on the podcast. We hope that you'll come back and visit us again soon sometime, okay?
Tomorrow.
Not tomorrow, but soon, okay?
We love you.
All right, say goodbye to the people.
Bye.
Say bye. We'll take a quick break and we'll be right back. We won't. She won't. She's going to bed, but yes. Jess and I will be back.
Hey, it's Wednesday. You know what that means. Rushed Vibes. Rush Vibes in the car, Rush Vibes in the gym, Rush Vibes on Wednesday, every Wednesday. Don't miss it.
Well, that was fun.
A lot of fun.
Candid conversations with a five-year-old who is convinced that she's the only five-year-old to ever be on a podcast. So for the longest time, she'd been saying she wanted to be on, and that was completely unscripted. And I didn't even find out she was coming on until last week's episode was recording and David mentioned it. So she's just been really, really excited. And it was fun to see that joy. She had a lot of energy that I was not expecting. But
yeah, especially this late at night.
Yeah, but she did an amazing job, which we had no doubts that she would. So now Solace.
Oh, she's going to talk about like on the bus. She's going to tell the bus driver, you know, I was on a podcast last night.
She's going to tell her teacher.
Tell the teacher.
So I'm probably going to get a text message. Is Solace really on a podcast? So that was fun.
But word of mouth, right?
Yeah.
Solace is going to be our little direct sales agent, spreading the word about Rush Vibes.
So, y'all should have seen her practicing. It was hilarious.
Yeah, she was like, hi, hello, hey. Hi, hello, hey.
This is Rush Vibes rushing.
And then we go live and she's like, hey, come on, girl. Oh. Goodness gracious. While we're talking about advertising and promotion, since we led with Solace, please do remember to hit the like button, subscribe if you're watching us on YouTube, and if you're listening to us, be sure to leave us a review and leave us a rating. 5 stars would be preferable, but you know, whatever you feel we're worth. Hopefully, if you're this is more than your first time listening to us, and you're enjoying what you get out of Rush Vibe. So go you're ahead
picking
and
picking up what we're putting down.
Picking up what we're putting down. Go ahead and help us get help our discoverability out. So here we are.
Here we are.
It's adult time.
Yeah. Solace kind of set the bar. So now
she set it really high.
It's been a week. It's been an interesting week.
Yeah, it's been a crazy week.
One of those, a lot has happened, but at the same time, not much has happened. We unfortunately.
What are you drinking?
I guess it would be kind of a spin on a mule. Got my little ginger.
Spin on a mule. That's actually a good name for a drink.
Spin on a mule.
Spin on a mule. Yeah.
I might play with that.
Coin it.
Spin on. It's mine. But I'm trademarking it. Don't come for it. So yeah, that ginger echinacea drink that we get from Trader Joe's.
Which has been oddly messing with my stomach lately. Like the first time you brought it home, I tore it up. Like it was just amazing, like the greatest thing since sliced bread. Like every time I sipped, I would hear angels singing like in the back of my head. Like, oh my God, this is a holy drink. But like the last few times you brought some home, every time, like I'll drink it and it's good. But then my stomach, it just does a little,
it's filled with ingredients that's supposed to like cleanse you. Ginger.
But cleansing and ailing are two different things.
There's a lot in your stomach that good things have to work
through.
What are you trying to say? I'm trying to say you're not the healthiest of beings. Okay, so
what this isn't going to turn into.
Because I drink it and I'm
on
just
on the back half of fine. Our children's segment is not going to be.
I'm just saying.
Rushed intervention vibes. Okay, that's not what we're about to do. I'm
just saying. Anyway.
No, but obviously I was talking to, since we're.
What are you drinking?
Red wine. I was talking to my boy Matt and I was saying I've got one last push in me to get my body in a certain condition. I've got one left. No, listen. I've got one left. And after that, I'm just going to let the dad bod take his course. Right.
You haven't bore any children and you're only giving yourself one last hurrah.
This is it. Because every time I get to a place where I'm finally seeing the results, like when we went to the beach down in Charleston.
You mean two and a half years ago?
And you were snapping pictures of your boy. With the water glistening
I was at a low
on my
angle.
Chest.
I was at a low angle. It's the salt. The salt.
I got my phone back and there was like 100 pictures of me. I was like, okay, Jess.
Because your phone is water resistant.
No, listen, there's nothing wrong with the thirst, okay? You were thirsty.
Ghanaian queen is chest, never thirsty.
My chest glistening with the finest, ocean water.
You like had just introduced
with the finest ocean water
to yourself. It quenched
your thirst. It served
that little high horse you're on.
It filled a need. So I was telling my boy Matt, I was like, I got one last in me, one last run. And if it does, if something comes up, like it's just so be it. Dad boss is going to have to take over. Because just the thought, the difference between now and the last time I was lifting weights is the thought of lifting weights makes me want to go get in bed. Like no matter where, I could be in bed and I want to go deeper into the bed when I think of weights. So I that's how I know, like.
It's not even fair. I lift weights. I see absolutely no results. I work out for about a month. I was doing one day a week, but for the most part, I was doing 2 day a week workouts. I started in August and he's seen like some toning in me, but I've seen none of it.
Shoulder area.
I feel like I've just bulked. There's muscle. It's all just padded and layered. So like
when we go out and I have an issue and I want to speak to the manager, I just tag Jess in and she just come out all swole and stuff.
Don't do that.
She'd be like, I got this, boo.
So now I'm swole?
Swole, like, yeah, your upper body is toned. I told you, you get cut. Like, if you've seen, you can't see your back, obviously, but if you looked at your back, you would be impressed. I'm impressed.
I can. What was I deadlifting? 205?
That's like two of me.
Yeah, I'm up there. I know I was squatting like 165 for a while.
Yeah.
But I stopped. My trainer just stopped telling me what I was doing. Because then I try to negotiate my way out of it. I'm like, so you don't think that's a little bit much for a little lady like me? But he don't.
The trainers don't care.
But I can leg press 310.
That's good. That's very good.
So I'm there. I'm getting there. I just want to see the results. So I'm just going to stop eating and keep working out.
I'm pretty sure that's not healthy.
It's not.
So you were getting ready to say it's been a week.
It's been an eventful week, but it's also been a docile week. Is that the right word?
Where
it's
just kind of depends on what you're going to say next.
I don't know. I think we've just gotten used to something always happens. So there's always something.
Well,
in the
I think
news
something
cycle.
Always happens relative to what you consume, right?
True.
Yeah, because I was watching Bill Maher from Friday, and they brought up the Myers Leonard situation. You know who Myers Leonard is?
I do not. I'm sure I've heard the situation, but don't know the
name. He's an NBA player. 11th guy on a roster, right? Mm. He was streaming himself playing Call of Duty on Twitch, and he used
the one who beat his girlfriend?
No.
Oh.
No, not that one.
Sorry.
It does, like you said, always something always happening.
My bad.
He actually used a Jewish slur, and someone obviously, you know, somebody recorded it and went on the internet, so he actually like had to put part of the apology. He was traded and then cut, and then he's meeting with like rabbis and doing like a lot of
he's doing the circuit.
He's doing the circuit.
Where are people learning all these slurs? I feel like I don't know enough slurs because people.
But it was funny because like the guests, this happened like 2 or 3 weeks ago, and the guests like had never heard. They had never heard of Myers Leonard. They didn't hear about the incident, but like I heard about it the day it happened. Like I saw the news breaking. As more and more people found out about it, I was watching it like in real time on Twitter. So it's just crazy how, depending upon what you dabble in, you know, something could always be happening or you
nothing
know,
at
it,
all.
It could be.
But
relatively
I guess
quiet.
I don't stay in basketball news. The only basketball.
Well, it went from basketball to a more cultural thing because it plays into cancel culture.
Mm-hmm.
So
he's essentially canceled, right?
Well, fortunately for him, he signed an extension before all this happened.
Ah.
So. I mean, he was traded and then cut
so
by the team
means
he was traded
to. Good. He's got to get better.
I mean, you know, he'll probably sit out the rest. I mean, somebody might bring him in on like a 10-day or a minimum mm-hmm. contract next year. I mean, he's 7 feet. I don't want to turn this into an NBA podcast, but he's about 7 feet. He's got some range. He's got a solid frame. I mean, he's like I said, he was like a 10th, 11th guy on the roster, but he's serviceable. If
so, he needs to move up to six. If he can become that sixth guy, then
let's stop because you're showing your.
I mean,
this is not this
the
is not
tenth good. Guy. If yeah. The starting lineup is five. The this tenth is, guy is really not the most important guy.
No,
so
yeah,
I'm
but
just
you
saying,
can't just,
if
you can't
he,
just like get up to. It's not just like.
I mean, if he conditions and
it's
he
not
trains,
like he can just move a couple seats up on the bench.
I'm not saying like Mario Brothers. He's just dropping over mushrooms.
He needs to switch seats with the guy in the sixth seat.
What I'm saying is he needs to improve himself as a player so that he can be more of. I don't see him becoming a starter, but maybe becoming that sixth, seventh player so that he has more value, so that he's kept on once this contract is completed. Speaking of NBA. A gentleman I appreciate, Mr. Paul Pierce, because he did play on the Celtics while I was living in Massachusetts growing up there, stomping grounds. He was working for ESPN.
Mm-hmm.
He was with them for like, what, 3 years? At least three years. Got into a little thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's the live. People, these live videos,
mm-hmm.
unless you are prancing in a meadow with small children that are yours, don't post live videos. It's just you just need to have control over the narrative.
What was this for the uninitiated? What was the live video of?
It was a live video of alleged live video of Mr. Paul Pierce high, smoking what appeared to be a joint, based off of the caption.
Him being high.
And he was accompanied by some female body movers.
They were dancers. They were strippers.
They were strippers.
Strippers.
Yeah. And ESPN fired him the next day, which...
Well, the next day. It took a couple days.
Next business day, I think it was. We'll say it like that. I personally... It's such a fine line, because he would still have his job if he didn't put it live. So I'm curious, and not everybody's doing this, because I know you ain't doing this, but most men in his position, you can fix your face because I know you're not, I absolutely know you're not doing it. Most men in his position are going to these type of events, are partaking.
I was almost in Magic City this week.
You were absolutely not almost in Magic City. That was not going
to
happen.
I had to live vicariously through my little brother.
Yeah. Anyway, so I don't know if I definitely don't think that they should have fired him. I don't think this is fireable. I'm not sure if ESPN is trying to go for this wholesome family sports broadcaster image that Paul Pierce now no longer fits, but I just thought it was a bit of an extreme. Like, give him a slap on the wrist, be like, yo, do what you're gonna do, but don't put it on live. Maybe they feel like kids are following him because, you know, they might be watching his stuff, seeing him on the TV and then wanting to follow him on social media. I thought it was a bit extreme. You know, I kind of teeter the line when it comes to cancel culture. I have my biases, but I just thought that it just didn't seem like the type of thing you do that you have to fire someone for, especially, you know, a former pro athlete, someone who has money. Like, this is what these guys do. If he didn't go live, all of this would have taken place anyway.
What do you mean, these guys?
These guys.
It sounds like a blanket statement.
These guys with money.
Okay.
A lot of these guys with money. I'll stand corrected. This is just kind of what they do. So I just didn't feel like it was fair for it to be like, oh, you've lost your job because you were living it up and you happened to put it on IG.
So a couple of thoughts. Number one, this definitely came up in the group chat that I have with my two cousins, Mark and Lamont, and my brother Donald. And honestly, and Charlamagne gave Paul Pierce Donkey of the Day on the Breakfast Club, and he posited that maybe they being ESPN and Pierce were already like on the outs with each other, and maybe that's why he went and did what he did, because he already knew that, you know, things were headed toward an end. It just it struck me as something that somebody who didn't already know that they were going to be fired or changing courses would do. Like, it seemed out of place.
Duck stage.
Yeah, like, they're about IDAT. I'm about to go my own way anyway, so let me go ahead and do this. And he only did it was alive, and there was only like 350 people watching. Now that's more people than who watch Rush Vibes currently, but still, for a celebrity announcer, a Hall of Fame basketball player, it is a very low number of live viewers. But there was a lot of action going on. There were women twerking.
Did you watch
people
it?
People throwing poker chips.
Did you watch it?
Poker chips at the at,
did you at watch
the
it?
I well, the thing is, because it was alive, and with Instagram, you have the option. You have the option to post your live to your feed, but mm-hmm. I don't think he did. So you're basically, if you wanted to see what happened, you'd have to go on Twitter and.
You piece it together?
No, I only saw like a little bit of it.
Okay.
Not that I felt guilty about it, but just because that's all I could find, and I wasn't gonna go searching, playing like Super Sleuth, trying to put it all together. But yeah, it didn't strike me as something that he would do if he didn't already know it was, you know, he was headed toward the end of the ESPN. But maybe he didn't. Maybe he just had a lapse, or just a FU, or not a FU, but F it moment. It was just like, I'm gonna have some fun. I'm high, like. Let's get lit. Whether or not he should have been fired, I think that he works for ESPN, yes. ultimately he works for Disney, the Mouse Company, Mickey Mouse Company. So, you know, they like to project a very safe, family-oriented atmosphere. And if they feel something goes counterintuitive to that, then they have the option to let someone go. So if this live actually was what caused ESPN and ultimately Disney to let Paul Pierce go, you know, I don't really have a problem with it. I could, they don't need help justifying it. I think if someone had captured him doing, like, if he was in the privacy of his own home, and you know they were just hanging out, and one of the guests or one of the doormen or one of the valet people, you know, had the little shaky cam footage of Paul Pierce, that'd be one thing because he wasn't projecting it himself. He was having a private moment. But I think because he went live intentionally and filmed like everything, like he was panning the phone so he can get both butt cheeks in the frame of the stripper behind him. Like, because he did all that, I think that's why they had no issues letting him go. So, I mean, it's justified. Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, but I'm sure he's not hurting for money or whatever. He's
Paul Pierce. I hope he's not. I hope he had a decent savings account somewhere.
It's interesting. But did that happen? Was that this week? I thought it was the week before last.
No, it was last week.
Oh, that's crazy.
At least it feels like it. At least I thought it was. I could be wrong, but there's that.
Yeah.
We lost two significant people. One affected my life more than the other. We lost DMX after it was several days that he was on life support. Very, very tragic. We were talking about how, you know, he was only 50, and 50 is still young. So to have lost his life in such a tragic way, it's really heartbreaking. I didn't realize I knew more DMX songs than I do. David, when he passed, we were out on Friday, and David was like, "Okay, we're just gonna listen to DMX all day." And initially,
and
she
started clutching her pearls.
I was like, "Look, something about
I can handle this thuggery."
I did say that, but then I don't know, the few times that I have had to listen to something to DMX independently, I don't know, we just the Rough Rider, there's like a small Rough Rider inside of me that comes out. It's a good thing I wasn't driving. Like, I get real New York in my driving and aggressive, and you know, I start doing the hand motion when people are in my way. I just get real aggressive, so I don't know that I was ready for it, but I handled it. We had to pay our respects, so we did that. But yeah, we did lose DMX and Prince. Oh, forgot his name. Philip. Wow, my brain went blank.
And you're supposed to be the Brit person.
I was gonna say Harry.
And you're supposed to be the Brit person.
I am. Forgive me.
I shouldn't be the one to correct you on
bloody
that.
Bloody hell, forgive me. Yes, at 99, we lost Prince Philip across the pond. I think they said he'd been married to
73 years.
Yeah, that's epic. That in itself is epic. I always wonder about like that type of relationship, and just, you know, just being royals, do you have like the same intimacy that just regular basic people have? But that in itself is, I mean, I don't really rock with the royals anymore after they tried to come for Archie's skin tone, but I can appreciate being dedicated to someone for 73 years. Now, I haven't watched The Crown yet, so I don't know what scandals took place like pre my existence. I know he's been known to have a sharp tongue and just kind of saying off the cuff stuff, but he was royalty. He's gone. I know his grandson Harry is headed over to the UK. I believe he arrived. Megan stayed in the States. She was
This feels like a segment on E.
She was like, "I want that smoke."
I'm catching up on all the
English tea.
All the tabloid
Earl Grey news. Megan stayed. You know, she's pregnant. She's also 39. So then they call it geriatric, because you're old. But
35 and up, baby.
Yeah, just. I'm sorry. So she stayed because she didn't want to take the attention, which I thought was admirable. But, you know,
maybe she's just pregnant and didn't feel like flying across the water, in a
global pandemic. She's also high risk. I think she's later along in her pregnancy, and after a certain point in your pregnancy, you're not supposed to travel.
When you're pregnant with Solace, and we went to my brother's wedding.
I think it's like after 36 weeks, you're supposed to stay.
We actually were in the doctor's office. We were like, hey, we got this wedding in Virginia. Can we go? Like, she was like, no. Jess was like, all right, so when we leave, we out.
And we went, and I had contractions at
the
wedding.
She was working the whole time. Like during the rehearsal dinner, so rude.
But I was dancing at the wedding, and I was having contractions. No class. And I'm sorry, I worked. I had
no class.
You weren't complaining when them checks were coming in.
Them checks.
My checks.
The checks.
So Harry is there. People are seeing.
We speak English in this house.
Harry has gone to the UK.
Speak none of that Ebonics.
Goodness, let me speak.
Keep that mess in the gutter.
I'm done.
Go ahead.
No.
Go ahead. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No. You're rude.
No, I am. But
you,
that's what I
so
do.
So you know you're rude? Okay. Thank you.
All right. Go ahead.
So he's flown over to the UK. Maybe they'll be able to make amends. The brotherhood and all that stuff. But yeah, Megan, she's later in her pregnancy. She's not traveling. They also say, you know, she don't want to cause no smoke. She don't want to like take the attention from this very intimate English burial of the prince. So that's what I got.
Rest in peace. It's DMX and
Prince Philip.
Big P. Big Papa P.
He's definitely...
Big Papa P. 99 years old. That's a long lifetime. Seen a lot.
So I'm curious.
Probably done a lot too.
Not trying to like speak death on anybody, but a lot of people who've been married for extended periods of time, usually when one goes, it's not much longer before the other because they're
not when you're the queen. Like when we got business to tend to.
I feel like it's her life's goal to ensure that her son does not become king. That's just it. I feel like Charles is going to die. She is going to outlive him, and then William will end up being king before she's like okay.
Yeah.
Because that woman's health, like I don't know who her nutritionist is. Y'all better figure that out.
She on that RBG.
She's got a strict diet. Like she doesn't allow them to eat like any rare meat. Like meat cannot be like meat has to be well done. Like if they travel,
steak and stuff, they cannot eat
a medium rare or anything.
I have no problem.
Unless it's cooked in Buckingham Palace, like she's strict. Buckingham Palace, where the Queen lives. But okay, again, enough about the royals. I'm cool with that. What you got? What's on your mind? What you dealing with?
You know what I'm dealing with?
Yourself?
A break. So let's take a break and then we can come back and finish up uninterrupted. Cool?
Cool.
All right. We are back. Rush Vibes in the building.
We never left
Rush
the
Vibes.
Building.
Rush Vibes Studios.
Rush Vibes owns the building.
Rush Vibes does own the building. We are back. I guess with what will be our final segment for the show. And, you know, I struggled with whether or not I wanted to discuss this because we led with our daughter, which is very fun filled, kid oriented, lighthearted segment. We transition into,
do I need another drink?
Two people dying. DMX, rest in peace. And Prince Philip. But over the last couple of days, news has come out of a young 20-year-old, to be exact, black man, dying at the hands of police. Just about 10 miles from where George Floyd was murdered. And Daunte Wright, that's his name, was pulled over because of expired, I think, registration. And also had an air freshener hanging from his rear view, which I believe is illegal.
What? You're kidding me.
I believe in Minneapolis, it's illegal to hang something from your rear view.
So where's everyone hanging their mask?
I don't know. I would imagine not from their rear view.
That is the most That is one of the most ridiculous laws I've ever. In what that's what way?
I'm going to fact check this. I probably should have done it before you came on, but I believe that's what.
So then they shouldn't sell them in the state. I really hope there's not an air freshener that's sold in any convenience store that is intended to hang off of. That is, okay, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to. That's just one of the most ridiculous laws.
Yeah, so police can pull you over for hanging air freshener. But I believe what got him pulled was the
fact that he's black.
The expired registration on his car, which, you know, due to COVID, there probably were, you know, DMV was probably backed up. Who knows what was going on there? That's obviously speculation, but I wouldn't be surprised.
He might have not known. I got pulled over one time. The one time I've been pulled over.
Yeah, he's just.
My dad took care of everything. Yeah. My tags had expired. I had no clue. Yeah. I'm from Massachusetts. I think, I can't remember how tags work in Massachusetts, but it's not at the frequency that they do in North Carolina. So it was literally the last thing. I got onto I-77. Troopers came up behind me. I pulled over and they did come at me like with hands on their, like on their guns. I remember I was like, I don't even know why I'm being pulled over. Why do you have your hands on your gun? Like, I'm just a little girl. And the guy was like, do you know your tags are expired? And I was like, my what? And he was like, your tags on your license plate. And I was like, I don't know. My dad takes care of that stuff and he's in Ghana. I was like, what am I supposed to do right now? And he was like, you need to go take care of that. And then I went to the courthouse and they were like, all right, you can leave. Like, they just dismissed it. Anyway, sorry. That's just my lighthearted, I don't take care of things. I'm low-key sexist and just expect the men in my life to handle things.
So the expired registration, I believe, is what got him pulled over. They obviously ran his information, and I believe he had an outstanding warrant for a misdemeanor. So it's nothing like serious. I mean,
if you put the word gross in front of something, I feel like by default it makes it serious. I was
nah. So he had outstanding gross warrant for a gross misdemeanor. So I think if you watch the police cam video, which was released today, they pull him out of the car. They put his hands behind his back. I believe at the point in which they tell him he's under arrest is when he starts to struggle, jumps back in the car. At this point, the officer who was kind of hanging back, whose camera the footage was captured on, comes in, tries to help, pulls her gun, and you can hear taser, taser, taser several times, and then fires a single shot into the car, hits Daunte, and then the car, I don't know if he fell into the steering wheel or what, but the car drives off. Oops, sorry. And then he crashes, and then he died at the scene. Mm-hmm. And I think at the end of the video, where you see the car leave the frame, you see two other officers who are kind of looking in the direction of the camera, like what just happened. It's been reported. I believe the chief said their training requires the firearm to be on the dominant hand and the taser to be on the non-dominant hand, so that instinctively, like, mm-hmm. you know,
you grab your gun to protect.
Yeah, from your dominant hand. So it was believed, it's said that the officer believed that they had pulled their taser and not their firearm, which is why they yelled taser three times, which you can hear on the video. And I think which is why everyone was so shocked when they heard a gun.
Now, is the
gunshot,
is the firing of the taser, and I've never shot either, but is it actually, no, I do have a taser, but it's a flashlight taser. Is the motion, is the mechanism the same?
That
if you would grab a gun and a taser.
I think that their ergonomics are similar. I think it depends on the model. But a question I put out on Twitter is that because I've never held either a taser or a handgun. I don't know the difference in weight.
You've definitely held my flashlight taser.
If it's distinguishable. So
well, that's what I'm trying to figure out, because I feel like guns are...
would be heavier.
Even though TV makes it seem like guns are nothing, they're significant. There's significance in weight to a gun.
Sure.
So you should know when you've grabbed a gun. And I wonder if at a certain point... You said it was a female cop.
Mm-hmm.
She had already pulled out the gun and just fired. But I know that there, I don't know if the taser required, and I'm not sure if all police departments do this, but I do know a lot of them, there's a special maneuver. You have to move your wrist or flick your gun to get it out of the holster to prevent someone else from taking it from you. So I'm curious, does the taser offer the same thing? Like there are a lot of,
I don't know,
minuscule details that one would wonder. Yeah, I didn't watch the video. I don't get a lot of opportunities to be privileged and just kind of block certain things out. I had done that with the George Floyd killing. If it wasn't for the fact that I was watching the morning shows the day the case came on, the trial started, and I didn't realize in the opening statements they were going to air the video. And by the time I realized it was the video, it was too far into it. That traumatized me. So I had gone out of my way. I'd gone almost a year without seeing it. I did not watch one of the Ahmaud Arbery videos. I just can't handle watching real lives being taken. Watching a TV show is one thing, a movie is another thing, but knowing that this person is what someone's going to say, not going to say, cut, this person's not going to stand up. So I've seen glimpses of it on the news circuit. Our one-year-old is determined to make sure that I don't get to live a life of being informed. So anytime something came on that I was trying to listen to, she conveniently had to babble. So I haven't really been able to watch it. I'm not going to make efforts to watch it. It's just too heartbreaking. But I am, it does raise the question. Recently in Charlotte, there was someone who, a gentleman who got shot and killed. He had a warrant. I think a U.S. Marshal apprehended him. And I won't say I thought nothing of it. It was unfortunate to me. But then within the same week, I can't remember what event happened, but one of the mass shootings that took place, I think it was Boulder. Mm-hmm. And wasn't there another one? Atlanta. Both gentlemen had been brought in, essentially unhurt, unscathed. And this one...
Well, the Boulder guy had been shot in the leg.
That don't count. He was still able to walk.
That's not unscathed.
Okay, partial scathe.
You literally got shot.
I mean, he was walking out.
He still got shot, Jessica.
It was probably like a dummy bullet. Anyway, so it was just it was just interesting that, you know, you have people who are committing mass murder, and they're able to get apprehended without losing their lives. And I'm not condoning petty gross misdemeanors by any means.
Such thing as a petty misdemeanor, too. They're different.
But they're not... If someone's record doesn't, in my opinion, and I'm not law enforcement, I don't know. I have family that's law enforcement I'm married to family that's law enforcement. No. I've married into a family with law enforcement. I come from a family with law enforcement. So, you know, I have great respect for the badge. I've always appreciated it. So I know I can't speak on many things because I'm not an enforcer of law. But I think personally, from a citizen's perspective, if you're pulling up someone's record and they don't have a record of violence, again, it's a lot of split second decisions, and I do understand and respect that as a police officer. You want to come home too. But I just find it interesting how some people are always able to get, I mean, look at what Dylan Ruth, was that his name? I mean, he was another mass shooting, and he was able to get apprehended safely.
Yeah.
And was treated to lunch. So it's just, I just wonder why this is always the case. And I don't know, Daunte, what's his name?
Daunte Wright.
I don't know his background, and honestly, none of that should be relevant. Because he's 20, he was a kid. His life is gone. There's no redeeming that. And it's just, it puts you constantly questioning police officers, and there are good police officers out there. But when these events keep happening and happening and happening and happening, and you're just forced to wonder why does this keep happening? Why are you smiling?
I'm thinking about the Chris Rock bit. Some jobs can't have bad apples.
You can't have bad apples. Like
some jobs, everybody got to be good.
Like, even teachers, like we'll let some bad teachers fly, but you can, like every
you know, American Airlines can't be like, you know, if most you of our pilots like to land.
If you have to train,
we just got a few bad apples
for a profession. You should be good at it. You should be top of the line. And it bothers me. It concerns me as the wife to a black man, you know. It's very
with locks.
So, you know, he's already stereotyped. And it's like, you know, DMV records, they're not going to have on the fact that he has a bachelor's and a master's degree. Like they don't put that there so that you can know that he's not a threat. He's just defaulted a threat to homeless people.
Right.
And that there are some days where I'm like, bruh,
that's my wife. I just look homeless.
Bruh, what is going on?
I have leaned all the way into this pandemic dressing. Wore this pandemic
wardrobe. He'll come down in a polo and like
my plaid PJ pants
and house slippers with these socks. And I'm like, what is going on?
Well, it's like Bethany said, the socks are part of my brand.
We need to remarket this brand.
Oh man, I ain't trying to be like everybody else.
Anyway, I'm just tired of things happening. And then you also have the video that's recently released of the police officer. I mean, not the police officer. The lieutenant, I believe he's in the army, who was berated by police, attacked, pepper sprayed. He did, in my opinion, he did everything right, but it was still wrong. And the fact that he was essentially being, I mean, they were berating him and saying that he should be scared and all of these. And it's just like, that's such misuse of power. Like you're literally, when you say police, it's to serve and protect. And if we can't trust you to protect, then like who are you serving? And then you wonder why. And again, I'm not condoning gang violence and all this stuff, but you wonder why, you know, gangs take over neighborhoods, because they're like, we're going to protect our own, because the people who are supposed to protect us have never protected us because they weren't designed to protect us. So it's just, I don't know what new training efforts need to be made, what de-escalation efforts need to be made. Like, at what point, if someone struggles, do you just step off? And if that's even a safe way to go about it. But, like, lives are not being valued. And it's sad that every week, every other week, we're hearing another case of somebody losing their life at the hands of police officers. And I can't even imagine what it'd be like being a police officer in this time, because people are either going to be loving you or hating you. But like I don't know. That's just my emotional feel.
So I have a couple of thoughts.
Just a couple.
Just a couple. Okay. Or a handful. Number one, it's probably the most interesting fact of the day is that when it comes to the top 10 most deadly jobs in the country, you know, the police don't even register on the list. Police officer. So that's interesting.
Really?
Yeah. Also, I want to be careful,
mm-hmm.
right? I don't want to get into hyperbole, just because we're reacting to something that we have become all too familiar with.
Mm-hmm.
I think if you look outside of the Twitter sphere and you look into predominantly black neighborhoods, I think you will find that they want more police presence. They just don't want to be unfairly targeted.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I think that we could afford to institute some or add more funding to government agencies and or create some agencies that can intervene in certain instances where police are like a last resort. But ultimately, I think, you know, it comes down to training. I think with this officer, everything that I heard the chief say on his press conference would lead you to believe that this was a training issue, because if everything the officer said is true, they had their taser when they they had their handgun, excuse me, when their firearm, when they thought they had their taser. Mm-hmm. And if they were trained properly, they would have known to recognize the difference. So there was a lapse in or a lack of training there. So I just think that training needs to be improved. And I think with the Derek Chauvin trial, with law enforcement people coming out and kind of saying, you know, we shouldn't have done that, and certain tactics are not acceptable. I think, you know, maybe there's been a shift where, you know, in years past, maybe cops weren't as likely to speak out against other cops. You know, that
the fraternal order.
That blue wall, blue line. You know, maybe things are starting to change a little bit. But I thought it was interesting to see as many law enforcement people speak out against Chauvin, like in public at a trial. But I just hate that being young, you know, usually comes with being able to make stupid mm-hmm. mistakes and dumb decisions and live to talk about it and live to learn from it. Mm-hmm. Right. Like part of living is hopefully falling forward, making mistakes and getting up and realizing your wrongs mm-hmm. and being a better person from it and being smarter and knowing not to make that decision again. And even if you end up in jail or prison, that's supposed to rehabilitate you so that you can, you know, you can be an asset to society when you come back and not a liability and not take away from it. So it's unfortunate that, you know, we've seen time and time again that young black men aren't afforded the opportunity to make mistakes mm-hmm. because a lot of these, you know, we see these encounters, they turn fatal because of whatever explanation you want to roll out there, poor training, perceived threat, non-compliance, like a lot of these things, it's almost as if they just become part of a rotation. Mm-hmm. And I just think it's unfortunate that if I could tell you all the dumb shit I did at 20,
I mean, that's almost that, what 20 is for.
Decisions that I've made that probably should have resulted in me being in a lot more trouble than I got into. You know, I've done a lot, but I've learned from those things, and I was fortunate enough to not be in situations where I didn't get to learn from them because it was the last mistake or last decision I ever made. Mm-hmm. So I'm just, you know, was it an honest mistake? It's possible. But I'm just, honestly, it's just like my heart just hurts that another young black man with a small child, you know, just wasn't allowed to make a mistake. Like, mm-hmm. should you resist? No, but can you blame someone for not trusting police? A young black man for not trusting police? Probably not.
And some things are just naturally instinctive. And I, again, I'm not condoning. It's just sometimes we're a fight or flight. A lot of people are fight or flight. And sometimes in that moment, you don't know what his bill situation was looking like. Who's going to bail? Like there are thoughts that are going through your mind so quickly.
Yeah, he was scared about not being able to see his kid.
Who knows where he was going? Maybe he
and his girlfriend was in the car too.
Yeah, so it's just a lot. There. I feel like there are a lot of elements that add to it. You had touched on, you know, the Chauvin trial, and you know, a lot of cops coming out. And I remember when, you know, all the chatter had started about the trial, and I wondered if it would have been. If there would have been less loyalty towards or more loyalty towards him if the actual murder hadn't been so long. Huh?
So what?
So long. Oh. So, you know, a lot of times these incidents against black males, black people in America from police is shootings. You know, you're just shooting to protect yourself. And the thought has crossed my mind, if Chauvin had shot George Floyd, would the perspective be different? Because it's not 9 minutes of footage of him heartlessly with his knee on his neck. That is such a savage, intentional act. Whereas, you know, a lot of the justification to these cases, I was defending, I was fearful of my life. I was fearful of my life. So I pulled out my gun, my weapon, which is supposed to protect me and others. And I shot this person. And that's, you know, instant conclusion. That's where it ends. That's where the video ends. So I was just wondering if that's what makes the difference in this trial. But, you know, the same thing. Rodney King was not shot. Rodney King was very brutally beaten. And people were still able to be like, So, I mean, I don't know. Saturday Night Live did an amazing opening skit. I don't know if you watched it.
No, I didn't see
it. Where they just, it was their cold open and they had Keenan and I can't remember her name. I believe she's Nigerian. And then two white anchors or faux anchors. And they were talking about the Chauvin case. They were pretending to be news anchors from Minneapolis. And the one of them was like, it's an open and closed case, and you know, he's going to jail. And the black people were like, And then someone else was like, well, you know, a jury has presented all this information, and there's no way they won't convict. And they made the So it amazes me that we still keep coming here. And then, you know, you think of other countries, like in Europe, a lot of countries, police officers don't carry guns. In England, that's not common.
Well, that's not going to happen here.
I know, but I'm just saying, you know, so it's possible to have people actually serving and protecting without weapons or lethal weapons. They still have the baton? That's what it's called. They still carry those. They might have upgraded to tasers, but they have tactical forces that they call on when it's time to bring ammunition to a situation. I think they were doing studies and they were showing how different nations train their police officers and the amount of hours, like it's more hours in America to become a barber than it is to become a police officer. Yeah. There in Europe, I think you have to study in some, maybe Sweden, it's like 2 or 3 year program of training, including psychological training before you can become a police officer. Whereas here, some people have the right heart, the right mind for it, but some people are like, I just want to be able to have power, and I want this badge to justify the power that I have. So, I mean, there are just a lot of things that this system, this American system, needs to improve. But police were not designed to protect people of color. The policing system is just another stem or branch off of the post-Civil War era and trying to confine people and control people. So, you know, I think low-key, I think America just needs to, let's just burn it and start from scratch. Not physically burn it, but I mean, like, we need to just go through all the different layers and see how all of these layers have gotten us to where we are, and we need to rewrite this stuff. But then y'all and your partisanness, y'all doing the most, so it's not gonna happen.
Yeah, I don't agree with that, but that's cool.
Burn because it down.
We get to disagree.
We should have a revolution.
Because this is a free
country. We
need
another revolution.
So I think that's a good place for us to stop. Because honestly, just talking about it, it's just got me. I can't really. I'm kind of done.
Well, I do have one positive racial note.
No.
UNC has hired their first black head coach for the basketball team.
I don't have time for this.
And in the press conference, when it was asked how he feels about being the first black coach, he said he's very proud of his white wife. Y'all have a great night.
So there's actually more context to it, which is why I didn't want you to discuss it, because we'll
continue next week.
But anyways, thanks to everybody for watching Rush Vibes. Like I said, connect with us on social media. We're on Instagram and Facebook. The icons will be popping up down here. Obviously, subscribe to the channel and hit the like button if you enjoyed this episode, as well as Young Miss Solace. We'll be back next week with a new episode. Episodes drop every Wednesday on your podcast platform of choice and here on YouTube if you're watching us there. You can support the channel if you want. We actually just had a really big donation. We were able to upgrade our computer thanks to a very fine donor. So thank you very much. We appreciate you. We love you. And yeah, if you want to support the channel, we're on Cash App. Are you $RUSHDVIBES? Anything else, Jess?
No.
All right. Well, that's it for Rush Vibes. Be safe.
Wash your hands.
Wash your hands. Wear a mask. Socially distance, as Solace said. Those are three things. That's all you got to do. That's just three things, and that's it. So we hope everybody's doing well. Hope you're enjoying the warmer weather. You're staying safe. You're staying well. Appreciate you watching. Appreciate you listening. Catch you guys next week. We out. Stop me now. Yeah, I done came way too far. Stop me now.